presents this unabridged recording of 44 Tiny Secrets, 44 Tiny Secrets Book 1, written by Sylvia Bishop and read by Imogen Sage. For my niece, Sophie, with oodles of love. Kiss. SB. To David, thank you for being an inspiration in every way. My compass led me to you. AK. Chapter 1. A Terrible Disappointment. Betsy Bow-Linnet really wanted to kick something, just to make herself feel better. It had been a frustrating morning, but there was nothing in the room that she could sensibly kick. Grand piano? Too valuable. Rare and exotic ferns? Too flimsy. Marble floor? Too hard. Grandad? Too alive. So instead, she took a very deep breath, which smelled of ferns. Then she put her fingers back on the piano keys and tried again. And yet again, it came out all wrong, with a rude kersplunk where the tune should have been. This time she did kick the piano, just a little bit. She wasn't wearing any shoes, so on balance this hurt her more than the piano. Ow! She announced. Everything all right, Bee? Came her granddad's voice from behind a fern frond. There were an unbelievable number of ferns in the Bow-Linnet's parlour. Her mother liked ferns too much. You couldn't sit anywhere without fronds waving in your face. Yes, thanks, Grandad. It's sounding very nice. Betsy knew that was a lie. Her playing never sounded nice. Her mother, Bella Bow-Linnet, was a very brilliant concert pianist. Her father, Bertram Bow-Linnet, was also a very brilliant concert pianist. Grandad was brilliant too, although not quite as brilliant as his daughter and son-in-law. It was only Betsy who was no good. But she needed to become good, very good, before her parents got back from New York. That gave her precisely 1 week. There was the rustle of a newspaper being put down. Then Grandad got up from his armchair and his eyes appeared over the top of a fern. Quick break for some biscuits, Bee, he said.
I'm all right, thanks.
Just a very quick biscuit, he said firmly. And a cup of tea. He was zigzagging through the plants and heading for the door before Betsy could protest. I'll be back in a jiffy. Betsy turned back to the piano and tried one more time. Tinkle-tink, tinkle-tink. Tinker-splunkle-splunkle. Ow! The ow was Betsy after she kicked the piano again. Harder this time. She rubbed her foot tenderly. It hurt quite badly. And since she had been practicing all morning with no success, she gave in for the time being. She hobbled over to one of the elegant armchairs in among the ferns and waited for the sounds of slippered footsteps and rattling crockery. Grandad could even make carrying a tea tray sound like music. He took forever, but when he came back, he had Jaffa cakes, which were Betsy's favourite. There was a pot of tea for him and some lemonade for her.
Now, Miss Betsy Bow-Linnet, said Grandad, are you going to tell me what on earth you're doing?
Betsy nibbled a Jaffa cake in what she hoped was a carefree sort of way and said, practicing.
I noticed, said her granddad.
He always flapped his elbows up and down as he talked. Betsy used to think that was how he breathed. He flapped them accusingly at her now.
To be more precise, you've been practicing since 7 in the morning on the first day of your summer holidays when you would normally be in bed with a book until noon. So I suspect, he poured himself some tea, that you have some beans to spill.
Betsy looked at her feet, partly to avoid looking at Grandad and partly to see if she had a bruise coming on her big toe. It really hurt.
So, said Grandad, spill them. It's just you, me, and a small army of ferns.
Betsy didn't know what to say. She loved her granddad. Her parents were away so often that a few years ago he had moved in with them to help look after her. Betsy had always told him anything and everything. But just thinking about last night made her chest hurt, and she didn't want to say it out loud. At last, she said,
I just want to be a better pianist.
Grandad raised his eyebrows and elbows in unison.
Why?
She shrugged.
I've told you before, Bee,
he said, more gently.
You don't have to like the piano.
No one will mind if you don't.
That made Betsy's chest hurt even more than her foot, because Grandad's voice was so kind, but she knew that it wasn't true. Her mother minded, and her father minded, and she hadn't even realized until last night. She had gone to their bedroom to say goodnight and goodbye. They were packing their suitcases for the New York International Classical Three-Fingered Piano Contest. As she was about to knock, she had heard her name and paused.
I do still wonder if we should have taken Betsy this time,
her mother had said.
She'd hate it.
That was her father talking.
Nothing but piano concerts from dawn to dusk.
Oh, Bertie,
her mother had said, and Betsy had heard a trembling sigh.
Do you think she's maybe just a late bloomer?
Bella, darling, no. Betsy just isn't a pianist.
Then her mother had snuffled and said the words that hadn't left Betsy's head all night.
Oh dear, I suppose you're right. It's just such a terrible disappointment.
A terrible disappointment. She, Betsy Bow-Linnet, was a terrible disappointment. So when Grandad said that no one minded, her chest tightened and she breathed in so sharply to keep herself from crying that she inhaled a bit of fern and choked on a Jaffa cake crumb. The choking lasted about 10 seconds, and then it half turned into sobbing, and she found herself telling Grandad the whole story from start to finish, ending with the bit where she would almost certainly never walk again because she had broken her foot kicking the piano. Grandad didn't seem too worried about her foot, but his whole face melted and drooped when she told him about the terrible disappointment.
Oh, Bee, I'm sure your mother didn't mean it, he said.
She did. She sounded like she was almost crying, but it's all right, said Betsy.
She scrubbed at her face fiercely and took another Jaffa cake for courage. Betsy Bow-Linnet might be a terrible disappointment, but she was no coward.
By the time they get back, I'm going to be good at it. Really good.
Grandad looked worried.
I am, said Betsy, determined.
You know, Betsy, said Grandad, your parents love you very much. I know they love their pianos too, but you matter much more. People that you love always come first.
What about Grandma?
Betsy asked. As soon as the words left her mouth, she regretted them.
Sorry, Grandad, she said quickly. I'm really sorry.
Before Grandma met Grandad, she had worked, lived, and travelled with the circus. She loved her old life, but she gave it up for him and for Betsy's mother for a while. When Bella was 7, Grandma had left. Grandad always said that she couldn't help it. She loved them, but she loved the circus more. Betsy wished she hadn't mentioned Grandma. She had said it without thinking. She was terrified that her parents loved pianos the way Grandma loved the circus, exclusively, untouchably, above all else. But it was selfish to bring it up. She glanced over at her granddad, whose elbows were very still now as he sat and thought. Whenever Grandma was mentioned, Grandad seemed to shrink a little.
It's all right, Bee, he said finally. It's a good point. But your grandma was an unusual case.
He was thinking. Betsy could always tell, because his elbows would go perfectly still and he would stick his head forward like a turtle. She waited. After a few seconds, he drew his head back again, mind made up.
Okay, Betsy, I'm going to help you, This week, we'll have a piano masterclass, but on one condition. If you're not quite as good as you'd like to be by the end of the week, you mustn't be worried or upset. Your parents will always be proud of you, whatever you do. Is that clear?
Betsy nodded. She wasn't sure if she believed Grandad about the last bit, but she did want his help.
I have two rules, he said.
He held up one finger.
Rule number one, never practice anything at full speed until you can get all of the notes right at half speed. Promise?
Betsy promised.
Good. Rule number two.
He held up two fingers and looked sternly at his granddaughter.
Don't kick the piano.
And they both laughed, which made her feel a bit better. Then he gave her a hug, which made her feel a lot better. But after that, the real work began. Grandad didn't mess around when it came to music. For the first 3 days, Betsy wasn't even allowed to play the piece she had been trying to learn. She was only allowed exercises. Exercises for the left hand, exercises for the right. Exercises at the top of the piano and exercises down at the bottom. Exercises to make her fingers nimble and to teach her to go la-di-da with one hand and tummity-tum with the other at the same time. Betsy hated exercises. It was hard to keep Grandad's second rule sometimes. Then, with 4 days to go, she started learning the music. Grandad played it first, so that she could hear how it was all meant to fit together. He played beautifully, elbows floating with the rises and falls, and normally Betsy loved to listen. But now, all she could think about was how different it was from her kasplunking version. Lummity-tummity-tum, went Grandad. Lummity-splunkle-bother, went Betsy. She was learning Chopin's mazurka in B-flat. This is a very difficult and impressive sort of piece, but when you are a Bow-Linnet, you have to do something very impressive indeed to live up to expectations. Betsy learned it one tiny section at a time, at half speed as she had promised. Her fingers fumbled over the keys hopelessly, like worms on roller skates, but Grandad was endlessly patient.
From the top, B, he would say. It's sounding lovely.
With 3 days to go until her parents returned, Betsy could get it right from beginning to end about half of the time. The other half of the time, she would still kasplunk somewhere in the middle. Whenever she did, she felt her chest tighten, and all she could think about was what a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.